Good morning and welcome to Pentecost Sunday, the day when the Holy Spirit came to the church. I broke my glasses this morning, so I don't know what the Holy Spirit was saying to me. Perhaps you can have a pray about it and tell me at the end of the service. But if they do fall off during the service, you'll understand why. A couple of things about members of our congregation. Lynn's mum, Pam, who is in Linden care home, is deteriorating quite quickly now and could be nearing the end of her time on this earth before going to glory. Lynn's mum has a strong faith, as does Lynn. This is always respectful in this time. Whether we can keep Pam in our thoughts and in our prayers this week. And also, Shirley Brooks' son, David, who's on our prayer list, is having an operation tomorrow, a cancer operation, quite a serious one. So also could we keep Shirley and her husband and David in our prayers as well.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
And as we come into God's presence, we pray to the Lord, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name.
What God has prepared for those who love him, he has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything. Therefore, let us in penitence open our hearts to the Lord, who has prepared good things for those who love him. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father,
we have sinned against you and against our neighbour. In thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, we are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life. To the glory of the Lord.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness. And keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. We stand to give glory to the living God. Glory to God in the highest. And peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God your Father. Amen. As we remain standing, let us pray. Holy Spirit, sent by the Father, ignite in us your holy fire. Strengthen your children with the gift of faith. Revive your church with the breath of love. And renew the face of the earth through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And we sit for our reading.
first reading is from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind and filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "And not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, from the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own language we hear them speaking about God's deeds and power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose. It is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken to the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, as I will pour out my spirit upon your flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. That everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful people and kindle in them the fire of your love.
Alleluia.
Please stand for the gospel. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus spoke to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have said these things to you, so that when that hour comes, you may remember that I told you about them. I did not say these things to you from the beginning, because I was with you. But now I am going to him who said to me, yet none of you asked me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, so it has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I will tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. If I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and he will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. But he will not speak on his own, but speak whatever he hears. And he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I say that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." This is the gospel of the Lord.
May I speak in the name of the living God, who is
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. When the Advocate comes, he will testify about me, and you also must testify. Each year we read this same account, full of drama and imagery, as we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit on those first followers of Jesus at Pentecost. And our Gospel reminds us again that Jesus had promised the Holy Spirit to be an Advocate and the Spirit of Truth, a Spirit that would testify on his behalf and empower them to testify to him for their lives. And it came just as he promised it would. It's a familiar story, but I found it unusually hard this year to know where to begin, because it took place in Jerusalem. And how can we not think of all that has been happening there and in other parts of Israel and in Gaza in recent days? It has been heartbreaking to see such conflict in our world. How much God's Spirit of Truth and its gifts of peace and unity, mercy, healing and joy are needed to break into the noise of human conflict and the suffering there and wherever it takes place in our nation, our communities, our individual lives. When that first Christian Pentecost happened, the noise in Jerusalem was one of separation, although that also was a turbulent time. Just a few weeks earlier, when the crowds were gathered for Passover, the noise was in calls for the death of Jesus. And now it was Jewish Passover, Jewish festival of Pentecost, or the Feast of Weeks. A festival of harvest thanksgiving, celebrated since the Exodus led by Moses, and the people would have gathered from scattered places to join in. At any other time, the disciples and followers as Jews might have been there for the festival. But this time they were there waiting as Jesus had instructed them for the coming of the promised gift of the Spirit. And when Jesus had spoken about it before his death, they had linked it in their minds with the coming of God's kingdom, asking, would this be the time the kingdom would be restored? But Jesus had told them it was not for them to know the times and dates the Father had set. And so it was that suddenly and in an unexpected way, they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in many languages as the Spirit enabled them. Above the noise of the festival, the crowds heard a new noise, the noise of God's Spirit at work, and they were bewildered and amazed. Though they had many languages, they heard these ordinary Galileans speaking in such a way that they could not only hear, but also understand the testimony of Jesus speaking directly to each of them. When the Advocate comes, he will testify about me, and you also must testify. Now Peter, filled with the Spirit, testified. And his gift of confidence in preaching, we later discover, converted 3,000 people with one sermon. This was going to be quite a different harvest festival celebration, as so many became part of God's kingdom. Not in the revolutionary way that they might have imagined, but a kingdom that is open to all who are willing to hear and respond. A kingdom that brings justice and peace, restoration and hope to a broken world. God, through his Spirit, can do amazing things through all you people. Those crowds that have gathered from scattered places would be going to their homes, and now it would be the disciples who would be scattered to begin their work of testimony to all the corners of the earth. And in Acts we have just a glimpse of how that happened. Some took the message home when they returned from Jerusalem. Philip went to Samaria. Peter was called from Joppa to witness to Cornelius in Caesarea. And Paul, after his conversion, made many journeys into Asia and Europe. And so it is that every Pentecost Sunday we look back and we remember how the powerful gift of the Spirit came on those disciples. But it was not just given in those days of the early church so that we can look back and give thanks for it. It is given to each of us today to empower us to go on and in our turn to be witnesses for God's kingdom. What happened that day 2,000 years ago was spectacular, noisy, and focused on language. But it isn't always like that. It was then, and perhaps it was necessary in the circumstances of the time. But the coming of the Spirit can be in spectacular events, but it can also be in that quiet inner voice or that feeling, an inner glow of flickering flame that prompts us to look and see, to act, and sometimes to speak. It came to them in a crowded place while they were gathered together in prayer and fellowship. But it can also come in places of isolation, in stillness, transforming individual hearts and minds. What the Spirit gave them was a new desire, a new enthusiasm, a new skill, a new power to tell people about Jesus, to testify to him through countless ways in their lives. This is what the Spirit did for them then, and makes possible for us now. Because however it comes to us, it will come with purpose, to lead us into understanding, to build our unity, to enable us to grow in the fruits of the Spirit and to become more Christ-like, and to equip us to share the gospel with whoever and wherever God calls us to. Pentecost reminds us that God uses ordinary people, even us, and through his Spirit he can work through each one of us, so that the world may be blessed as he always intended. And perhaps more than ever, we need to see that Spirit at work in our world, in our churches and in our individual lives. The Spirit of truth who empowered the early disciples is with each one of us now. And the Spirit of truth will dwell in us forever. With the Spirit's help, we can live out our faith and follow the commission Jesus gave to be his witnesses in the world. It may be through language in the sense of speech and words, but it can also be through the language of hospitality, of kindness, of peacemaking, love, encouragement, or any of the other gifts that Paul described as gifts of the Spirit. We do not have to scatter to the four corners of the world as the first disciples did, but thank God that they did. It may be that our places of mission are in the room where we live, where we work, or where we meet others yourselves, not to make a name for ourselves, but to the one who gave himself for us for the coming of his kingdom, and to his praise and glory alone. So we pray again, as we prayed in baptism. Holy Spirit, sent by the Father, ignite in us your holy fire. Strengthen your children with the gift of faith. Revive your church with the breath of love. And renew the face of the earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Services here. And We pray for Andrea and Anne this morning as they are admitted at the 10:30 service as church wardens and for the new PCC. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for the troubled spots of the world, particularly praying for all those in Israel and Palestine. And we pray that the ceasefire may hold, and that there be a lasting peace, so that both Palestinian and Jew may live together in harmony, as you intended us to live together in harmony. And we continue to pray for other areas where there is violence, including Myanmar. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray as we come out of lockdown, all those suffering from coronavirus, all those who have lost people, all those who have lost employment, and all those who live in areas of the world where there isn't the same medical support that we receive, especially thinking of the people of India and other countries where health services are struggling. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for all who are unwell, anyone known personally to us, and those on our lotus sheet this morning, the moment of quietness has held them before the Lord our God. And we pray too for all who have died, remembering those whose anniversary at this time, including Mick Merrifield and Roy Moore. Merciful Father,
It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. This day we give you thanks because, in fulfillment of your promise, you pour out your Spirit upon us, filling us with your gifts, leading us into all truth, and uniting peoples of many tongues in confession of one faith. Your Spirit gives us grace to call you Father, to proclaim your gospel to all nations, and to serve you as a royal priesthood. Therefore, we join our voices with angels and archangels and with all those in whom the Spirit dwells, to proclaim the glory of your name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is she who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
So Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with Mary, Albans and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven, through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Being made one by the power of the Spirit, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus, the Lord of the world, grant us peace.
Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Alleluia.
Open our lips by your Spirit, that every time tongue may tell of your glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise, that when we were still a follower, you met us in your Son and brought us home, dying and living into your glory. Give us grace and hope in the age of glory. May we share Christ's body with the mysteries of life. We need a drink to drop up with life to others. We need to spare us if we are right to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free. And all our earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Now may the Spirit of truth lead you into all truth. Give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and strengthen you to proclaim the word and works of God and the blessing of God Almighty. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.